Dysautonomia is a term used to describe dysfunction of the autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system is part of the nervous system. It regulates your heart rate and blood pressure. It controls your gut motility or your digestion, controls your temperature, your sweating, and also tear production. And most people take these functions for granted, but when this part of your nervous system is impaired, it can lead to life-altering and disabling symptoms. One of the most common manifestations of dysautonomia is a syndrome called POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. This syndrome is defined by impaired heart rate and blood pressure regulation. The autonomic nervous system does not work properly, and the blood pools in the legs, leading to less blood flow return to the heart and consequently less blood flow to the brain. This leads to a number of symptoms of orthostatic intolerance, where patients do not tolerate standing for prolonged periods of time. Patients can experience dizziness, brain fog, and profound weakness with standing, as well as a racing heart. Many patients also can experience exertional intolerance, where even the smallest activity can lead to them having weakness and muscle aches for days. And many patients with POTS also have a significant fatigue. And this is not fatigue like most people get after working a long day. This is fatigue, severe exhaustion, bone-crushing exhaustion, in which activities of daily living, such as going to the grocery store or even getting up and walking across the room, can cause severe exhaustion. Many patients get symptoms of dysautonomia and POTS following Lyme disease, and there's many reports of this in the literature. And this is not a new phenomenon. There are treatments that can target the dysautonomia and help give the patient some quality of life back. There are numerous autonomic tests that can be used to diagnose dysautonomia. The most commonly known test is called the tilt table test, where the patient lies on a table and the heart rate and blood pressure is monitored with the patient laying at rest and with the patient in an upright position. If the heart rate increases by more than 30 beats per minute when the patient is tilted upright, then that is diagnostic of POTS. POTS and dysautonomia is a dynamic disease that can wax and wane. So sometimes patients have flares where they're increasingly symptomatic, and other times they feel better. And so sometimes when we do a tilt table test, for example, we may capture a patient on a good day and it may not be diagnostic of POTS, even though the patient clearly has a history that's consistent with the syndrome. There are numerous treatments that are available for dysautonomia and POTS. To treat POTS, the foundation of the treatment is really lifestyle change. So increased fluid and salt intake to optimize the circulation and improve blood flow is very important. Compression stockings and an abdominal binder can also help to pump the blood back up to the heart and brain where it needs to go. Many patients with POTS cannot tolerate normal exercise programs, and they need to have an exercise program specifically designed for them. Other treatments are targeted towards gut or GI tract dysmotility. There are many medications that can increase gut motility. And then there also are many medications that can improve circulation, either through reducing the heart rate or increasing the blood pressure or targeting the autonomic nervous system itself. We know that many infections can cause POTS. POTS after Lyme disease and COVID-19 share many similar symptoms, and they also look a lot like patients with myalgic encephalomyelitis, or also called chronic fatigue syndrome. And this has led many people to hypothesize that these syndromes all share a common underlying pathology. There are a lot of interesting studies showing that the autonomic ganglia may be affected in these syndromes. The autonomic ganglia is a cluster of nerve cells that lies at the sides of the spinal cord, and they are responsible for transmitting signals from the environment to the brain. there is an enormous mismatch between the number of patients with dysautonomia and medical providers with knowledge of this field. Especially with the COVID-19 pandemic, there is now an enormous influx of patients with dysautonomia, and the medical system has had a lot of difficulty accommodating these patients. Many doctors are not aware of dysautonomia, and so it's common that many patients will see multiple specialists before the possibility of dysautonomia is even brought up. And even once a patient is suspected to have dysautonomia, it is difficult to find autonomic testing facilities and also find a specialist with knowledge in this field. There's a lot of exciting research right now in discovering novel autoantibodies or blood markers in patients with dysautonomia. These can be a sign of a dysregulated immune system in this disease, and more research is needed to understand which patients have these autoantibodies and how it should affect our treatment. Many of these autoantibodies target the autonomic nervous system. There is a lot of exciting research right now on the use of immunomodulatory medicines to treat dysautonomia. One of the most studied medications right now is a medication called IVIG, or intravenous gamma globulin. This is a medication that is used to treat many autoimmune diseases, including myositis and myasthenia gravis. Our experience tells us that some patients with dysautonomia may respond to this medication, but clinical trials are currently studying this right now. My particular research interest is in discovering novel immune biomarkers in POTS after Lyme disease and COVID-19. I'm also interested in studying the immune dysregulation in dysautonomia and understanding which patients may respond to immunomodulatory medications. I hope to develop novel biomarkers and treatments for patients.